ask, have you got an outfit sorted?
Outfit sorted. Do you want to start that one?
Yeah.
Why not? Why not? Why not? I did see that it's in progress.
Yeah.
I'm getting ideas at the moment from a whole range of people, from players, friends, family. So there's a short list being developed. You got any ideas for me?
Are you going to Crows jersey or a West Coast jersey?
No, we're not going to stay away from the jersey. It's something a little bit more. Okay. I think Neil wants us to have a bit more fun with it. So, no ideas.
Maybe just the Speedos?
The Speedos.
Tutu.
Tutu. I'll see how we go. I'm not sure the Speedos, I'm going to be able to pull that off.
Could
have
been Bora at Ben King, maybe?
No, I think that's going to be a bit of room too far, to be honest. Not sure that's going to fly, but yeah.
What about the initiative on the whole kid? I suppose happy to pick up the phone and say, yep, I'll be there.
Yeah, look, it was, when it was first sort of floated around that, there's an opportunity for all of us to do it. I think every coach, pretty much jumped at the chance to get behind Neil and a great cause. And it's going to be an interesting day. It's going to be a fun day, I think. And that's what Neil wants us to do, is have some fun with it and obviously raise awareness, but some funds. And it's, for me personally, I lost my father to MND, so it's something that's pretty close to my heart. So when, it was floated that, we'd all get on board, it was really easy for me to say, yep, let's do it.
How impressed have you been with the work, Neil? And
Yeah, he's been amazing, yeah. I've known Neil for a while, but I sort of worked with him at West Coast when I was back in the first year back at West Coast, and he'd just been diagnosed at that point. His drive and his passion for the cause, for what he's going through, will leave a massive legacy around MND and hopefully a cure in the future.
What about you, obviously, getting over there? We've been in Perth on Sunday night, so when do you actually catch a flight over? Are you going on the same flight as Ross, or how's that going?
I don't know how it's working with Ross necessarily. I'm flying out pretty early Monday morning, so we'll fly straight in there. Go to the G, head down into the cold water, and then back on the plane back here Monday night and get ready for obviously the game against Hawthorn on Saturday night.
So does that mean, you say you come back Monday night, so you're not staying in Melbourne
with
the coaches?
No, we've got a 6-day turn into Hawthorn, so keen to get back here. Obviously we've got players back in on Monday, they'll return from Perth on Monday, and we'll get back in on Tuesday, ready to prepare for Hawthorn.
Are there things you'd want to raise with Gill if you could be there, or...?
I may have a conversation before the night. I mean, those nights, I haven't been to one as yet, so when I gather that nice food and drink red wine and talk about footy, so it's probably not a bad night, but if I've got any pressing agenda, although the communication with the AFL is pretty good, I'm in regular contact with people in the AFL talking about the game and how they're seeing, and certainly this year they've invested pretty heavily in game analysis and game understanding in terms of what's going to happen with regards to rules or changes or everything else. So I think the work they're doing is pretty measured and pretty thought through, so I'll miss the dinner, but I'll be there for the slide.
On the whole, the bigger picture, not even specific to the Crows, anything you would raise to Gill, like see improved, guidelines and everything?
Without going into the specifics, I mean, there's obviously the committee that's now in place that's looking at the whole game, whether it be the game itself or, the way that it's being officiated, the way the rules are, that's sort of where the game's actually headed. So there's that group that's together doing that. And I think the process they're going through is really, really valuable, because it's now going to be really measured. They're going to take a lot of opinion from a lot of people and come up with things and try and actually assess what often happens is it's the unintended consequences of a rule change or something else that changes that ripples into something down the track that we then have to adjust for again. So I think the process they're going through is really good.
John, just on a few players within the side, how's Tom Lynch tracking? Is he looking like he'll play this week?
Yeah, Tom's got that side strain, which he'd be unlikely at this point, based on how he's presented. He's going to get better day in, day out, but at this point it looks like he's probably unlikely. Dougie with his eye is in reasonable shape, so the report that came back from him, from the surgeon, not a surgeon, the specialist he saw, indicated that he's looking likely, more likely than unlikely. And Rory with his hand, that's really just a matter of how comfortable he can get, so we'll have a look at him tomorrow and see how that goes. There's a bit of swelling in there at the moment, which would have to settle down, and he'd have to be comfortable to be able to get out there on Sunday.
If you are without Tom Lynch, who do you expect Mike captain the side?
Yeah, well, if Tom's out, then that leaves the last remaining man in our leadership group, Matty Crouch. So it'll be, and it's an opportunity for Matty. He's coming to leadership group this year as a young man we know has got leadership capabilities and has already shown that at our footy club. So if that was the case, then it would be Matt, and he'll be ably supported by the guys who've previously been in our leadership group, so Daniel Talia, Richard Douglas, Sam Jacobs, Eddie Betts, have all recently been in there, and those guys understand they have a responsibility as well to assist him if that was how it plays out.
No thought of giving the captaincy to someone more experienced, like Talia or Betts or Jacobs?
No, I think Matt's in there for a reason, and we put him in there on the basis that we want to develop his leadership, and you know, here's an opportunity for him to actually do that. And sometimes with younger players, and it's the same with players who come into the team who are looking for an opportunity, not till they're presented with it do they actually step forward. So I reckon it's if that's the way it pans out, it'll be good for me.
Are you worried about the lack of senior players in the side at the moment? Given, I mean, guys, names like Sloan, Walker, Lynch, some of those.
It's not ideal.
Obviously, yeah. No. But are you worried about the lack of experience, I guess, from that leadership point of view?
Well, those guys clearly would prefer to have in the team from that, not only from a leadership view, from a playing viewpoint. I think the other thing is that, as I said before, the guys who have been in leadership group before or have got experience playing, that it's just them recognising that they have a bigger role to play. And they're the discussions we've had, and they're very aware of that. So, but those guys you mentioned are strong leaders and have been really good leaders for the footy club. So clearly there's a hole there, and it's how quickly we fill that hole and the responsibility they take.
You said enough to suggest the blokes that you have brought in can be vocal leaders on game day?
Yeah, well, some of them certainly. And the first thing about leadership is, of course, to lead through your actions and lead through your performance. That's the best way to genuinely lead, is to show a signal, this is how I'm going to go about playing. And some of the guys we've brought in have shown some good stuff in that space. And then the verbal stuff comes more secondary. I know playing under John Worsfold, you know, he was a great leader. But wasn't the most verbal guy, but he's very strong with his action and his demand, and what he did on the field sort of signaled us how we're going to go about playing. So there's different ways to lead.
Is it hard to teach that sort of verbal? Well,
it is, and some guys are naturally more reserved or quieter. It doesn't come naturally. And I know some of the guys who've captained in the past, they probably their most fearful moment is the 2 minutes before the game where they have to talk to the whole group. And some guys will do that well, and other guys less so. So it's all part of the, if you like, the tapestry of being a leader. There's different ways for different people. The most important thing is that they just be themselves.
Jacobs has been battling the last few weeks. First of all, is his body, is it all right? And two, would it be an option to give him a rest this weekend?
Yeah, look, he hasn't had a great couple of weeks, Sam, and to his own permission. And he's probably that back has set him back a little bit when he did that. I think that was 3 weeks ago. So I thought on the weekend, though, his form in the ruck was solid. He probably didn't generate the ball that he would be accustomed to around the ground. But his ruck work overall, I was happy with him. So he's one who's working back to good form. So we're not really in a spot where we're saying we're going to necessarily rest him, but we want to see him increase his performance. Yeah.
In a normal situation like this, would you be tempted to try and swing the axe? No, given your injuries, but normally would you like to sort of...
Well, it's really dependent upon the individual and the positions, to be honest. And as I said, 2 weeks ago, we had a horrible game against Melbourne. And that was pretty much across the board. On the weekend, there was some positive signs for some guys, and it's really just a matter of the performance over a period of time is what it actually looks like, who's basically knocking down the door for that position or role, and then sort of what flexibility they also provide us. So we sort of weigh all that up. And then in terms of making changes on form basis, we look at that, as I said, on a role.
I asked you last week about those blokes knocking down the door. One, are there any of those blokes that have put together a body work in the sample?
Yeah.
And two, are there any coming back from injury this week that might help you?
Yeah, I think McPherson comes back, which is good from the footy club's viewpoint. He's a guy that's obviously had an interrupted pre-season, and he gets an opportunity to come out and play. They didn't play last week because of the bye, so the guys didn't have a run last week. We had to train them over the weekend. So in terms of that, was probably unfortunate because some of the guys who'd come back the week before couldn't get another game under their belt. That's just the way the draw worked. There's a few guys there or thereabouts, but we've also got a few guys who have just come back from injury themselves who are just needing a few runs under their belt to really press their claims.
Can I ask on the injuries, Lynch, first of all, is that muscular thing on the side there, ribs? Or?
No, it's muscular. It's not ribs, from my understanding.
Yeah, and landing with the hand, to layman, a broken hand doesn't seem like something you can play on in a week, but it's obviously not a big deal.
Yeah, well, it's not, as I understand it, it's not displaced, so it's not like he's got a clean crack that's not going to, that requires setting. You know, sometimes you need to pin him or whatever else, so it's just a crack. Now, again, some people you can play on those in a week, it just depends on how sore they are and how it affects either your ball handling or your ability to do what the game requires you to do in a tackle space or in a spoil space as well.
How important has he been for you this year?
Oh, he's had a fantastic year. So he's probably been our most consistent performer across the year. So fingers crossed that he gets up.
Just one more on Sam. Given he's been, you know, such a good player for a long period of time, there hasn't really been too many options for the younger ruckman to come in. Is there a succession plan in place, given Riley O'Brien, I think, has only played about two games, and the rest are untried? Is there a succession plan in place?
Well, Riley O'Brien's the guy I mentioned. He's the guy that's, you know, I'm pretty sure if you grabbed him this afternoon and said he was going to play, he's been looking forward to playing for a while. So he's the guy that we've been, if you like, grooming in that space to be a viable alternative, to be a ruckman. And his form, I reckon, the last month, the sample's been pretty good. So, you know, he's sitting there waiting for an opportunity, and we made the decision as to when that is. But he's the next in line.
Don, I'm texting Rory. Chance for them to come back next week before the bye against Hawthorn? What do you think after the bye this day?
Texas is a chance, I would say. And that's really just a decision for us to make on Texas to when we think, and it's feedback from him and the program that he's been undertaking, when we actually think he's ready to go. Watching him train last Thursday, probably saw him running around in there. He's moving pretty well. He did another session over the weekend, another session on Monday. So he's tracking really well, you know, really confident with Tex. Rory's probably more likely post-buy, I would think, at this point. And that's more based upon the feedback we're getting from a combination of our doctors and the surgeons who've reviewed him to make sure that that's completely healed before we really expose it to maximal change of direction, you know, hard push and drive off, which is where he initially had the problem. So he's probably more likely after the bye.
And Brody Smith looked really good last Thursday as well.
Yeah, he's flying. Brody Smith, he's another one that, you know, the back half of the year we've got some decisions to make as to how ready he is. And A, there's the recovery from the actual ACL itself, and then B, there's just his need to get some match fitness in. But he's nearly in full training with us now, which is great news.